class. I welcome you to our chemistry lesson today. And in our lesson today, we are going to discuss the large-scale production of sodium carbonate, which means our discussion will center on how to produce sodium carbonate in large scale and how important this sodium carbonate, especially to industry, and therefore that is where our discussion will center on. And of importance is first to consider the uses of sodium carbonate that will then justify our production of this sodium carbonate in large scale. And one of the uses of sodium carbonate, as indicated here, is that it is a raw material in glass and also in paper industry. So it means sodium carbonate is used to manufacture glass and also is used in paper industry. Number two, it is used in water treatment plants. It is also used in making sodium silicate, which is also one of the compounds used in detergent making. These are just but some amongst the very many uses of this sodium carbonate. And now, actually, to indicate that this is an important compound that is required in various industries, and therefore it needs to be produced in large scale. And our focus will actually be on two ways of producing this sodium carbonate in large scale. However, I also want to reiterate the fact that in the process of when producing sodium carbonate, actually sodium hydrogen carbonate is also produced. And the importance or one main use of this sodium hydrogen carbonate is that it is used in making healthy or health drinks and also in baking powder. So we can see that in the process of producing sodium carbonate, also sodium hydrogen carbonate is produced, which is also a very important compound also in industry, as indicated here. Moving forward then, sodium carbonate is extracted in two major ways. The first one, A, is the extraction of sodium carbonate from trona. We're going to look at what trona is. It actually happens to be a double salt. Then also another way of extracting this sodium carbonate is by preparation using the Solvay process. So we look at the first process of producing or extracting this sodium carbonate from trona. Now, for the extraction of trona is actually a double salt. It's a double salt of sodium carbonate and also sodium hydrogen carbonate. And it also contains some water of crystallization. This is the formula of the double salt. This is trona. Sodium carbonate is also has sodium hydrogen carbonate and also water of crystallization. And this trona is found mostly in some Rift Valley lakes, and particularly in Lake Magadi. And this is a summary of the extraction of sodium carbonate from the trona. So from this flow diagram, there is trona from the lake, so it is being excavated from the lake, and then it is taken into this washery. You can see washery is actually some washing is taking place. That's why you have water here to wash, to clean that trona, remove impurities, and then the wet trona is then passed through the centrifuge, where drying and also purification of this trona is done. So the centrifuge main purpose is to dry the wet trona and also to purify it further, to make it actually more pure. Then you now have the dry trona into the kiln. Now, kiln is where there is actually heating, and in the process of heating of this double salt, this trona, then you end up with sodium carbonate
amongst other products that we're going to see in a short while, when we shall be looking at the actual equation for this, the decomposition of this trona to produce one of the products being sodium carbonate. Then into the heat exchanger, and then it is grinded just into various sizes. Then it is sieved, and then bagging, and also storage, and then it is sold to consumers. So briefly, this is what happens when you extract sodium carbonate from trona, as indicated here. So some of the key highlight notes that you need to know, that the trona is actually dug by bucket dredges, and then it is taken to the washery, and then in the washery is where you have the trona being washed to remove mud and also small particles of rocks. At the centrifuge, removal of water and purification of that trona, that is drying and purification. And at the kiln is where you now have the dry trona being heated to temperatures of about 300 degrees Celsius, and is where now you have the actual decomposition to sodium carbonate. And this is the equation for that, the decomposition of this trona at the kiln. So you have the double salt undergoing that decomposition to produce now sodium carbonate. There is carbon peroxide produced, and also water. Now, one other thing that is important, especially during the extraction from this trona, is that like in Lake Magadi, you have the trona and you also have sodium chloride. The two actually are in that lake, and therefore when the extraction of this trona occurs, actually during the day when the temperatures are about 40 degrees Celsius, trona crystallizes, and it is being, or it can actually be removed, because it will crystallize and then it can easily be removed. But during the night, when the temperature is about 21 degrees Celsius, sodium chloride crystallizes and can also be removed. So it means these two can actually be extracted, or can actually be maybe extracted at different times based on the difference in temperatures. At night, you will have sodium chloride being removed, and then in the day, you have trona being removed. Remember, also sodium chloride is an important compound, and it is used in industry for so many purposes. Now, so that is a summary of the extraction from trona. Another way of extracting or of production of this sodium carbonate is by the solvaying process, and this is applied in mostly in places where trona is not available. The major raw materials for this process, one, you have what you call concentrated sodium chloride or brine. Another raw material is ammonia. You also have calcium carbonate, limestone or limestone. This mean one and the same thing. And you also have coke. So these are the main raw materials for the solvay process. Of importance is to appreciate that the raw materials are very cheap, or are fairly cheap, can say that, and also readily available. So these two factors actually will make this process to be very economical to be carried out, because if the raw materials are going to be cheap and readily available, then the solvay process will be deemed to be economical. Now, I want us to focus on the flow chart, the flow diagram for the actual solvay process, and we have it in this format. This is where you now have the raw materials being used in the process, and we have what you call the ammoniating tower, we have the solvay tower, we have the filter, we have the roaster, we also have the kiln, the slaker, and this reaction chamber on this other part of this the flow diagram. Now, our focus will actually be at the point where you have the production of sodium hydrogen carbonate that can now be heated or can actually be roasted in the roaster to produce sodium, to produce sodium carbonate. And that is where our discussion will start from the Solvay Tower. So the sodium hydrogen carbonate is formed at the Solvay, at the Solvay Tower, and this is the equation for that reaction. So you have the brine, a concentrated sodium chloride reacting with ammonia, water, carbon 4 oxide to produce sodium hydrogen carbonate and also ammonium chloride. And that is why after the reaction in this Solvay Tower, then you have this being in solid form, this sodium hydrogen carbonate, ammonium chloride will be in solution form, and that mixture can be separated by filtration. That is why the mixture is actually filtered off. In this Solvay Tower, you have ammoniacal brine from this ammoniated tower, and you also have carbon 4 oxide that actually originates from the kiln after the heating and the decomposition of this calcium carbonate to produce calcium oxide and carbon 4 oxide, and the entire reaction occurs in the Solvay Tower. Now, so after the filtration, you have sodium hydrogen carbonate into the roaster, and the ammonium chloride will actually be filtered, and then it will meet with calcium hydroxide from the slaker. So in that roaster, this is the equation for the reaction at the roaster. So at the roaster, so you have sodium hydrogen carbonate. When this one is heated, it produces sodium carbonate. It produces carbon 4 oxide and also water. So then that. So you already now have our product here, sodium carbonate, which you actually wanted to produce, but in the process, carbon 4 oxide and water is also produced. So these two are actually recycled. And for this recycling, then it also means that we are making the process to be more efficient, more economical, because we are minimizing on wastage and also minimizing on pollution to the environment. So sodium carbonate is collected here. Now, the ammonium chloride produced here, so the ammonium chloride produced, another equation, ammonium chloride produced, now will combine with the calcium carbonate, will decompose to produce carbon 4 oxide, and then calcium oxide with water will form calcium hydroxide, which will now react with ammonium chloride. So you now have your calcium hydroxide reacting with calcium hydroxide, and you'll have ammonia and also calcium chloride and also like that. So the reaction between ammonium chloride and calcium hydroxide will produce ammonia gas, calcium chloride, and also water. And also this water will also be actually will be recycled. Now, calcium chloride will actually be said to be a byproduct. So it's a product produced in the process of producing the intended product actually. So this is a byproduct, and it is also a compound, a substance that is also useful in industry, and it can still also be packaged and also sold to consumers who require it. Anyway, for this ammonia gas, the ammonia gas now will actually move up into this ammoniating tower to combine with the actual source of ammonia, probably from the Haber process, this ammonia into the ammoniating tower, where you will have brine trickling down Also, because brine is also a raw material which is required, so brine will combine with ammonia to form what you call ammoniacal brine. And now you have that ammoniacal brine into the solvent tower to combine again. We have this reaction taking place. Now, at the kiln, as we summarize this, the solvay process, at the kiln, you have this reaction taking place. Now, calcium carbonate will undergo decomposition to form calcium oxide and carbon four oxide gas. So this carbon four oxide is this carbon four oxide that goes into the solvent tower. Calcium oxide will now go to the slaker, or will be taken to the slaker, where this calcium oxide combines with water. This calcium oxide, so from here you have your calcium oxide combining with water to form now, to form calcium, to form calcium hydroxide. It is this calcium hydroxide then that combines with this ammonium chloride from the filter to form ammonia gas, calcium chloride, and water. So you can now clearly see that this calcium oxide will combine with water to form calcium hydroxide, which now combines with the ammonium chloride. So that essentially is a brief description of the solvay process. And worth noting is the fact that a number of things are recycled, one of them being ammonia produced here is recycled. Carbon four oxide also produced from this roaster here is actually carbon four oxide from the roaster is also recycled amongst other items and other products. So that briefly summarizes the solvay process as an important process in industry, and it is applied in places where you don't have trona and the raw materials, as indicated, you have concentrated sodium chloride, you have ammonia, you have calcium carbonate of limestone and coke, and these raw materials are easily and readily available and also cheap. That makes our summary of our discussion on the large-scale manufacture of sodium chloride.